So just so we have it. So welcome everybody online as well. If you had mute yourselves, that it'll work better for listening to everything. So that would be great. And again, we'll wait just a few more minutes and get rolling. So trying to do everything. We'll see. This first time I tried to do Zoom and big screen. So far it works. So, right. So has anyone else been to Iona? It's here?
Ireland,
okay. Ireland, yeah. That's actually, well, I won't go too far into it because there was a really neat, surprising experience with one of my classmates as well on the trip, but I'll wait. I won't share too much until I get going here. So, right. Again, we'll... thanks everyone online for muting yourselves and all. Get going here in just 1 minute. All right. Right. Not that I really want to see myself, but all right. Well, why don't we go ahead and get going? Welcome everybody. Again, this is kind of sharing a little bit about my trip to Scotland and Iona, the pilgrimage that was done by put on by the Episcopal Church of Colorado. Now that Tracy Methy, who is in the Faith Formation Office, put this one together. They've done a lot of different pilgrimages, a lot over to Spain and the Camino and all that. They're doing one to the Holy Land later on this year as well. And then this is the first time they tried a Scotland and Iona pilgrimage. So it was kind of, we were learning, they were learning. Our guide who took us along the way, our hiking guide, was learning as well. But a great opportunity. We spent 5 days hiking and then 5 days on Iona, basically, and then a few days front and back in Glasgow and other areas there. So part of the Iona community, they have their own worship book. We worshiped out of this morning, noon, and night and everything. And so I'd like to, this is their welcoming service, and this is a prayer that comes from there. So let us pray. You, O God, have brought us to this thin place where earth and heaven embrace. The past interweaves with the future. Different nations and languages mingle. And what we want is replaced by what we need. And if we feel strange because this place and those around us are unfamiliar, and if we feel tired because we have traveled far, and if we feel uncertain because we do not know what is before us, still let us gladly say, God, you are good to us. Bless those who have left behind. Bless those we have left behind. Reveal your wisdom through those we meet. Rest your peace on what weighs heavy on our hearts. And plant your purpose in what we deeply desire, so that when we leave, we can say with truer conviction, O God, you are good to us. Amen. So yeah, on the island of Iona, and we'll talk about that here in a little bit, the community of Iona gathers 40 different people every week on a Saturday and builds community for 5 days. And then they send us off on Friday. They have a little bit of rest, and then they welcome another 40 people in. An amazing ministry, an amazing experience, as long as you're ready for that experience. So that's one of my surprises, and we'll talk about that here in just a little bit. But as we get started, again, James Methy, one of our participants, the husband of Tracy Methy, put the trip on. He put a slideshow together, so I'd like to share that a little bit with you all. And then Steve L'Esperance, our senior warden, asked me when I first got back, share your trip with me in 3 words and all that. And so those 3 words were epic, for sure, wet, definitely, and then surprising. and all that. And we'll talk about each of those as well as we go on. But let me share the screen here so folks on Zoom can get it as well. And we will watch the slideshow here real quick. Let's go. And it does start in silence, so don't worry too bad right away.
David. And there's a woman down in the region, saying about that good old man, a story from the good Lord. Oh, sisters, let's go down.
Oh, sisters, let's go down. Sisters, let's go.
Ginger. Ginger. Come here.
All right. I had to stop this before something else. Like I said, let me get back to
boosting their metabolism every night as they sleep by adding one unusually ready for a glass of
water. You know, that's one bad part about using YouTube, right? At least it's not as bad as Sunday morning. I was showing the other video from here at an ad came up that wasn't great, so let's just leave it at that. Those who are there know. So that's just a little bit of the, let me get back to gallery view here so we're not looking just at me. Come on. So just a little taste and all that. The song Down by the River to Pray, we sang that together a cappella as we were right before we did our renewal of baptismal vows on the one of the white shores of Iona and everything. We were going to do it at St. Columbus Bay, but we hiked there the day before, some of us, and it's just all real big rock and really hard and a lot further to get to. And some were very tired, and it just didn't seem like a good place to renew our baptismal vows. But so we did it up at the other part of on Iona, the North Shore. But the pilgrimage started. We flew into Glasgow. I'm gonna go ahead and share screen here again and show you some pictures through this, I hope. Okay, so this is our group, minus one. We had 13 of us that went. This is actually a Cathedral Ridge. So we formed a community probably about January or so. And we met online every single morning, every Monday morning for morning prayer and kind of get to know each other a little bit. And then about a month before we left, we had a retreat down at Cathedral Ridge. I was able to be there Friday and Saturday morning, and then had to come back here for a funeral and everything. But so we gathered there, started building community a little bit more as we were getting ready to go. And then we headed out for our journey. And so that's one too many. Nope. Somewhere I thought I had a bigger picture. So flew into Glasgow, and then we kind of we stayed a few days in Glasgow, and then we made our way up towards on the mainland up towards Ben Cruachan Inn. So right here, Ben Cruachan is one of the major mountains there. They call them mountains. It's a they're just lost a word. Anything over 3,000 feet there is, they have a term on it and everything. There's only a certain amount in there and everything. So I just lost that name, but that's okay. You know, we're like, wait, we're hiking 14ers and all that and stuff here. But So we started our trip here, and we've kind of came back a little bit and hiked around. And 2 days kind of hiked into Oban, and then we took the ferry across and got onto the island of Mull. So we stayed in Cranbier, which is right about here in the middle of the Mull. And then we kind of hiked the southwestern coast around and all that. So spent 3 days hiking over on the island of Mull until we got to Finneport and all that. And that's where you take the ferry over to Iona. So again, here's a little bit closer in. So we stayed at Oban and then made our way over here into Cangir, and then again hiked quite a bit down through here. We would hike about 10 to 12 miles, and then we'd come back to the hotel, rest, have dinner, have drinks, and all that. And then they would take us back to where we basically about where we stopped, and then we would hike on and then hike. So we did 3 days here. The third day, I took a break. I didn't hike that. It was supposed to be an 18-mile hike, and they cut it short to a 13-mile hike. All that. By then, I had blisters upon blisters on my heels. You know, they say don't change anything on race day. About 3 weeks before I left, my chiropractor gave me inserts for my boots and everything to help the bottom of my feet. And they were great on the bottom of my feet, but it raised my heel just enough that it was on the wrong part of the boot. So that was the nice thing is we had many people took, you know, like a 3 mile hike instead of the 12 mile hike. And there were out places that they could head out and everything. And then we got over here to Finneport and then took the ferry over to Iona. And also this is the small island of Iona. And then one day we came up here to Staffa, and that's where the puffins are. So we came up here to see the puffins and everything. So again, and then so this is like a week on Strava. So this is where we are on the island of Mull. Well, this was the second day hiking. This was the most epic piece. Because we were just right on the coastline, and you'll see a lot of pictures from there. So this stretch here is right about 13 miles and everything. And then we get back on the highway, come back to our hotel, and then come back in here, and they hike the rest of the way. But this is the road, so they went way down here and then came back. I decided not to do that hike. We did 4 or 5 miles that day instead of the 12 or 13. The total hiking that for the people who did the entire thing was right at 78 miles, I think it was, everything. And I did about 63 of those. So I was happy. And you know, to be honest, some of it was just I needed a day of rest. I also wanted to kind of see, I spent one day looking at the island, going on hikes there, but just seeing the town a little bit and everything. So that was, for me, that was good and all that. So this is our group as we started heading out. I've noticed in most of them, there's only 12 people. I mean, only a few pictures. We had all 13 of us. But this is the parish of Glenorchy and all that, an old-time parish. So we stopped here. We had communion inside. This was our very first day. And then we started our hike from there. With that, we started hiking. A lot of it was on road to begin, probably the first 3 or 4 miles. But then you can see the road up here. And then it drops down and it comes way up over here. And then up on the top, the road just ends. It's all dirt road. And then we just bushwhacked, but there wouldn't be bushes around. But went over there, we hit the saddle to look down, and it was just, there was not a trail and everything. So this is us getting ready to head up that dirt road coming off the asphalt and all that. And we'll go way up here.
Father Brian?
Yes, this, sir.
Father Brian?
Yeah.
We can't see the pictures on our screen on Zoom at all. They're not advancing. Just thought I'd let you know. Others are putting it on the chat, and I thought I'd let you know at least.
Okay, they're not advancing?
No.
All right, well, let's see what's wrong here. Let me. Thank you. Yeah, I can't see.
If not, we'll just listen. We'll just listen either way if it doesn't.
I know, but yeah, that'd be fun to. Let's see. Let me just make sure. All right, can you see that?
That's all we've seen.
Okay, let me see it now.
We can see that one.
Right. Yep. Just a second. That, does it change it now?
Yes, you may have to do it manually each time when you get up there. Yeah, there you go.
Okay, so let me get back to where we were.
Thank you.
Now they're changed. Okay, thanks for letting me know. So yeah, yep. So we basically were hiking up this road up into the clouds and everything. And is it changing for you now?
Yes, it is.
Okay, so this is at the top. The road, you can see, kind of comes all the way up here and then down to right here. And then we started off country, if you will. It was very wet and marshy. You can tell we all have rain jackets and everything. But once we got off the road, it was just, there was water underfoot all the time. We had waterproof boots, our gaiters, and rain. Most people had rain pants as well and everything. So, and then again, just some amazing views from up on top. And again, way down here, you can kind of see the road. We started down in this valley here and everything. And then this is, as we made the top, all of a sudden, the lock, the lake down here is where we were going. But again, you can see a little bit of two-wheel drive trails every once in a while. And that's just from the sheep farmers and everything. All this is private land. But unlike the United States, you know, it's kind of funny, flying over, I started watching the Yellowstone series, and it's all about Montana and basically this huge landowner being the mafia and keeping everybody off his land. You know, I mean, don't even cross my fence. And here, other than your garden area, which is a fenced off area within a certain amount of distance of your house, everything is open to the public to walk on and all that. Everyone respects it. You close the gate if you find it closed. You leave it open if you find it open. But it was just very different, just a whole different understanding. And, you know, here in Colorado, you're told, do not get off the trail. Stay on the trail. Otherwise, you're going to kill that vegetation. And it's all good. Here, they're like, no, we want you to scatter so you're not making one trail. But again, they weren't worried because it's all moss and everything else. The moss and the peat underneath, you could just grab it, you know, reach down into here and just grab a handful and squeeze it, and water would just flow out. It was just so different than anything that we experienced here or experienced there, other than I came back and it was about as wet. But so again, this is us coming down. We're trying to get to this road here. We are also told we'll get to the river crossing. There's a creek here, and then it runs into a river. That was the amazing between springs and everything, springs and then just a water runoff. There were rivers, creeks, everything else everywhere. It was just so, so wet. So then we got down to the river and started crossing there. It was a much bigger river than the guides were expecting. And afterwards we found out if we would have gone further towards the lake, we could have crossed over a little bit easier. But again, a great time. And I, you know, I'm a fly fisherman. We'll get to that. I cross rivers all the time with no problem. Ha ha. So this is still on our first day hiking out. So we came down the river or the lake that we were looking at. The lock was way up here. And then we had to hike out still about 3 miles on a road and all that. But again, no cars, no nothing there. So that was our first day, about 12 miles or so. And then we started at another church. Again, each morning was started in prayer and everything. So we gathered in this old church. It's a tourist area and all that, so it's always open to the public, but they let us in an hour early so we could have it to ourselves and then also have our prayer there. They're trying to create a Camino-type experience on the islands. This is St. Conan's Way. And so we're, Wendy, who is with us, as soon as I see a picture of her, I'll share. She was our guide during the whole time and everything. So she and others on the islands are trying to get the St. Conan's Way to be much like the Camino and everything. But it's, you know, again, we're pioneers, if you want, or we're still trying it. And they're like, oh, we shouldn't have gone that far this day, or oh, we should have done this. And they were learning too, because obviously they had hiked it a bunch themselves, but hiking with a group of 13 people from all ages. I mean, I was second youngest on the trip and everything. Mike Orr was with us as well. But we had one lady, 78 years old, and she still runs triathlons and things like that. She did the entire thing. She was a rock star and all that. And others, again, cut it back a little bit and everything. So the second day we were on a road, it's called the Bishop's Road. It's a road that's going over towards the island of Mull, and they would take that, they would take all the dead bishops there and then get them onto the island of Mull and get them over to Iona to bury them on the on Iona by the abbey and everything. So this was the Bishop's Road. And on that, all kinds of animals, very different. These are Highland cows. I kept thinking, oh, they're so fluffy. probably don't want to hug one of them. But again, just very different animals and everything. I was just blown away by all these old stone walls and all that. I mean, that's how they divided everything back then and all, way back in the time of history. Just a little selfie. So this back here is Lynn Cochran and all that. So we started way over on this side, and we hiked on the back side of this, came over, this is the saddle we came over, and we dropped down, and that lake is behind this mountain here and all that. And so that was that first day of hiking. So kind of fun to look back and say, wow, we did that. And again, just some beautiful scenery. I think on this road, we probably passed 10 cars maybe in the entire day, a bunch of bicyclists. And then we also met a gentleman in the slideshow, had a picture of him. He was a pilgrim going all the way from Iona all the way to the other side of Scotland, where, oh gosh, what's the name of it? Just lost it again. Sorry, I'm tired. Where St. Chad and St. Aidan were and all that. I served at St. Chad's, I know this. But again, so he was walking the entire island. But it's really cool to meet another pilgrim. He started where we were ending and everything. I think his trip was going to be about 4 weeks and all that, hiking all the way over and everything. So that was kind of neat to run into another pilgrim going the opposite way. This is kind of the group. So this is Wendy. She was our guide for the entire time. Wonderful person, and her dog is in there, Wallace, to find Wallace. And then this was our guide this day, who kind of knew. And he was a great guide. He knew everything and kept talking about it. Some of the people on the trip were like, we don't want a guide like that. We want that silence. We want that, you know, we had hiked over on the backside of Ben Cochran, and that was a really silent time. And then he was chatting up, and again, it was really interesting things, but there are a few people who are like, you know, that's not what we're here for. We're here for silent pilgrimage and everything. So, and then just sheep all over and everything, and what they leave behind as well. But it was amazing to hear. And for me, one of the amazing reflections was, you know, we hear about Jesus as shepherd, and you know, they'll hear my voice and they'll call. And there was lamb season, and those lambs crying out to their mothers, and every lamb had its own cry, and the mothers knew which lamb, you know. And so we were on one, and this little lamb was just behind some rocks and just crying out and crying out. And we had stopped to rest on the first day. It was when we were still up on the road. And so, you know, a few people were like, you know, should we go get the lamb and, you know, put it on the other side of the rocks? I'm like, no. And finally, the mother came up on top of the rocks and just did a little bleeding, and the lamb like, oh, okay. But it was, for me, it was really cool because the mother didn't come down and get the lamb. It was just like, I'm here. We're going this way. Figure it out. And so the lamb had to figure out how to get up there and all that. But again, it was just one of those moments throughout the trip where it's like, I kept just thinking of Jesus saying, you know, I call you by name. And there was one day on the island of Iona where I was in the abbey in the church, just early in the morning, total silence, all alone. And there's one little lamb outside bleeding and all that, just bah, bah. And I'm just like, okay, I hear your call. Let me enter into this space in a new way. We did have drinks. That was nice. One nice thing, and unlike the Camino and all that, we could leave our stuff behind. We came back to nice restaurants and all that. They had the best gin and tonics out there. This is actually a gin and tonic. All that, where they had this grapefruit. It was the berries from the juniper berries and the sprigs and all that. And I looked at it going, oh my gosh. And it was just amazing. What I didn't know is every whiskey distiller, most of the time they have gin as well. a special gin because the same products and byproducts and all that of it and everything. So I tasted gins all over. Everyone else was doing whiskeys and all that. But it was nice to kind of be able to step back and rest and all that. Just caught my attention, both the mailbox and then the phone booth there. So this was us crossing one of the rivers. And if you notice in some of these, most of these pictures, this is the third day of hiking. Most of these pictures, I have two trekking poles. At some point I'll have one and we'll talk about that in just a minute. But so this trip, this was the third day. This was going along the coast and everything. And this is where the epic comes in. It was just such an amazing day. Just the vastness and not a sight of anyone else or any tracks of anyone else other than every once in a while you'd see some old tire tracks and all that from the sheep farmers going out there. But so we were hiking along and came up upon the coast and we just started going up that coastline. And again, just huge spaces, little portrait there. And then, so that's our group. And so this is Wendy, our guide, and Wallace, her dog. And then this is our other guy for the day and all that. And he knew this spot really good. When Wendy was with us our own time, and then she hired other guides that knew certain sections of it better and all that. So, but again, you know, look at the ages and all that and stuff. And it was just amazing on some of these older folks, and just they were troopers and all that and all. So that was pretty wild. A few of them turned back shortly after this and went back and all that, but the vast majority of us kept going there. And again, just the coastlines were, you know, again, you just don't see this in Colorado. Another just portrait. And again, so what we did is we got way up over, and there's actually another mountain over here. We got up there and then we kind of crossed over and dropped down. It's kind of like in Colorado, you look up there going, okay, that's 2 miles or so. It was 5.5-6 miles because it's just up and down, and I didn't get that in my head till later and everything. So so just, again, just some amazing scenery there. Now that's Tracy and James, husband and wife team there. And again, just some amazing stuff. Again, way out in the middle of nowhere, here's those old walls, and you can just kind of see it go up here. It goes up the mountain here. Like, how did they lay all those rocks way back then? Because it does go up right up to the cliff and starts up on top of the cliff again and everything. So, yeah, just more hiking stuff. And again, just that vastness of space. Some of the pictures, and there's another one where it's just this huge space and this tiny little human way out in there and everything. But again, we didn't see anyone else on this hike and all that. It was asked about helicopter tours and things like that. And the guides were just like, no, we don't do that type of stuff. And actually Mike Orr, the communications director for the diocese, like, oh, you know, that would be, you could really make a killing with that. And he's all thinking finances. I'm just like, it is so nice to be out here, not hear a plane, not hear a helicopter, not have helicopters fly along the, you know, if it was the Grand Canyon or something, you'd be seeing most of that in many places. And also, and again, just locks or lakes everywhere you turn and all that. But, and just the vastness of space, again, just wide open. So this is my pack on this hike. You'll notice my one hiking pole is really nice. The other is broken. Being the person I am, we came up to a small little creek. It wasn't from me to Jay and all that. And there were rocks, like 3 rocks in there. I'm like, I can cross this. I've crossed rivers all the time. So I get across and I step up onto the other shore or other side. And it was up probably about 2 feet or so. And I got up and then also I lost my balance. My pack kind of pulled me down. So I put my pole down. And as soon as I hit the bottom of the creek, everything was just slicker than snot. So I slipped and then there was about a 3 foot waterfall, or just a fall down into a big pool and all that. One of the other gentlemen tried to catch me and he slipped into it. So we both ended up in there and all that. The amazing part is, you know, I had my rain pants on, I had my jacket on, and then actually I just had my fleece on and everything. And then, but I had rain pants, the gaiters, and my boots. And I'm like, just get in. And so I went into the pool, got out, and thinking, I'm just going to be soaked.
And Chairman Comer will, as dry as could be, in a minute, uncovered a highly unusual weather.
Whoever's on Zoom, if you can mute, that would be wonderful. Thank you. So that was my little embarrassing moment. The guides came up, we got all settled, and then they're like, okay, whenever we get to a crossing, do not cross until we get there. So then the joke became, Wendy, may I, and all that. So I stopped, even at a little one, and just say, Wendy, may I cross, and all that. So I ate a little crow there and everything, but again, and just epic scenery there, and crystal clear. And I was sitting there going, oh, I want to fish all this and everything. A lot of this didn't have fish. It had other aquatic animals, but there's not a lot of fish habitat in it because it's just natural spring stuff. And, you know, they don't plant them in there. There, you know, there's no, on the island of Mull, I was hoping to go fly fishing one day, not hike. And they're like, I'm not sure, you know, there's one estate that might have fly fishing, but, you know, that's going to be really pricey because it's all estate stuff. So, and then I just stopped even asking about it and everything. But yeah, so you know, just scenes like this where it's just, you know, you're just out in the middle of nowhere. So probably have too many of these. And so this is hiking back down in, again, just goats everywhere and all that and stuff. Wild ones, that, and then all, obviously some that were marked and all that and stuff. Didn't realize, and I don't know, maybe I'm getting a little too personal. A lot of the sheep had marks on their backs and everything, you know, either red or green or blue and all that. So apparently when they bring in the males and all that, they put a little pad on them and all that. So when they mate, that ink gets on the female, and then they know when they were inseminated and all that. And so there's, you know, for this particular, where we were at, there were three different colors. So they brought the males in three different times to stud and everything and all that. And so that's the way they mark it. And it was just an interesting fact I never knew and all that. So that's kind of really interesting for me. And this was, you know, as I talk about epic, this waterfall goes way up here and comes down, and I'm in the oceans right down there. And as we hit there, I have a video, but just didn't show it enough to show, but the clouds and the mist were rolling up and then over. And it just, you know, it's just that Holy Spirit moment. I kind of assumed my thin place, that place where I met God in the, you know, there, where that split between our reality and God's reality, it's right there. I figured that was going to be on Iona. Everyone said Iona is such a thin place. For me, the thin place was on this hike. It was just, again, epic every time. And it was, you know, a 13-mile hike, and I never got tired other than my feet hurting because of the blisters, and I just put up with that. It was just amazing. So, and then again, coming down, lots of creeks. That's about the size of the creek that I fell in and all that. So, again, pretty sad that that's where I fell, but all the fun. So, and this is James Methy coming up the hill. This was kind of our last big hill to climb on that third day. Oh, and then, just Mike Orr up there. And then we got into these trees and all that. They said just head for that tree line towards the end because everyone was just trying to push out and be done. And so we got in these trees, and these are all planted trees harvested by the, or put in by the Wildlife Division or the Forestry Division. They're all planted in rows and everything. It's just really weird how they did it, but you know, the islands have been just so devastated of all lumber for ships and everything else that there weren't a lot of trees on there. So they're trying a bunch of reforesting projects. But, and then this is the muck and the mire that we, well, muck, I guess, they're probably not mire, but that we were hiking through. So this one, obviously we had to go way around on this one, but there were places where, you know, you post hole in the snow up here. There are places where you're going through the bog and all of a sudden you just go down to your knee in just mud, and you're hoping your boot came back up with you and everything. So so this is Island of Mull. So we spent a few days here and then over to Iona here, just to give you a guide there. And then, so the last day, that's one of, so this was the second day of hiking on this. And then the last leg that came down through here, to Finneport where we caught the ferry. I decided not to hike that one. We hiked a little bit with them and then we caught the road and came in. So this is us getting, this is actually on the ferry. So this is Iona coming over on the ferry. This is the Abbey here. This is called the Bishop's House. This is the Episcopal Church, the Scottish Episcopal Church owns this. It's a retreat center. It's got a beautiful chapel. We'll see the chapel here in a minute. And then some homes. There's only like 138 people that live on the island. And only if you live on the island can you have a car, and you're limited to one car and everything. And, and most people didn't even have a car, because then you have to take the ferry back over and everything onto the island. So a few of us decided not to. We got the ferry over early and then just started hiking Iona. Our luggage was still with the other group. They would transport it. So then I took the ferry back to get help get everyone's luggage back that day and all that. So this is just us coming off the ferry. And all, in another picture, I think it has us with all of our luggage. But and then just amazing white sand, beaches, flowers, and all that was really kind of cool there. There's another tighter shot of these flowers, and then just some really black rock along with all the moss on it. And then, so this was just us hiking around Iona for the first, as we were waiting for everyone else to arrive. And then this was us coming up. There's a road that comes from the ferry up to the Abbey and everything. And so this was kind of our first walking up to the Abbey experience and all. Another picture of the Abbey and little gardens, and then so this is a garden for one of the hotels, and then over here is the cemetery, and again, a lot of sheep, even on the island. So, and then again, just the white sand beaches, kind of being have the experience. So this is when we got to the Abbey. This is one of the Celtic crosses. There's another one that doesn't have the arms even. It's just so worn and all that. And that dates way back to not quite to Columbus Day and all that, but dated way back. And this is the Abbey. So this Abbey has been rebuilt multiple times. So for those who don't know, St. Columba, it was back in 521, he was born, became a priest, was in Ireland and all that, worked with St. Patrick most likely and all that. He was exiled from the island and all that, banished. And the details around that aren't really clear. So they sent him off, or he left, depending on which myth you want to hear and all that, or which story you want to hear. And so he sailed in this round boat and he landed on the island of Iona. So he was, Columba was the one who brought Christianity from Ireland into Scotland. Everything, and it all started on Iona, and then he built a monastic community from there, and that's where all this has been torn down, or destroyed, built back up, destroyed, built back up. And so what we have now, the church that's standing now, back in 1938, the Reverend George MacLeod and all that came to the island and felt like his call was to rebuild this abbey and to make a community there. And all that, and create a community. They just redid it in 2021. They reopened it after remodeling all the bed, all the bathrooms and the hospitality places. The church was still open for visitors, but the Iona community took a little bit of time to regather and to rebuild that. This is the coldest, dampest place I've ever worshiped and all that. I mean, when we, you know, it was in June, May, early June, and we would grab our jackets. I'd put on my hoodie and then the jacket to go worship and all that. They just don't run the heat. You know, they had a little bit of heat in there and all that, but I was amazed at how cold it was. That's a big baptismal font. This is just as you walk in, and then the altar obviously up in front there. Be still. This is what I was expecting when we arrived. This is what we were all expecting and looking forward to. After 5 days of hiking, 7 days on the island, it was like, okay, now we can come and rest. I was thinking the monastic, like going to Christ in the desert and being, and this is the surprise and all that. We got there and it was like walking into a activities desk of a cruise ship, all that. What we didn't know, and actually with that, where to go? The somewhere here. I have their bulletin. Well, there. If you look at their calendar, I'll find it here in just a second. Share it with you. But here it is. So this is the calendar of the week and all that. I don't know if you're online and can look on the little screen, you can see that. But it is just super busy. So there's meetings of good beginnings, creative space, group listening, the Iona community today. It ended with an open mic session. We decided to do something. We were going to sing Down to the River. We pray. So I was like, okay, I'm going to support our group. So I went there. There was an old ditty being shared, and it's an old Scottish ditty, and it's about these little tiny skinny kids that she was washing in her bathtub, and then they would slip down the drain and all that. And she lost like 6 or 7 kids. I'm just like, this is not how I want to spend my last day on Iona. So as soon as I grabbed all my stuff, we did our little skit, we were the third or fourth one, and I hit the door. Mike Orr was already at the pub drinking, and I joined him. I texted him, "You still there? I'm coming." I was ready to be still, and you could find those still places. The community is amazing. They do great work, but it's just very different than a monastic field. There are no monks there. There are no nuns there and all that. There's a community of volunteers. Some have been there 3 years, some of them 2 months, some of them just arrived. So you can go and serve there, but their whole mission is to form community in 5 days. So every Saturday they get 40 people together and they form community. They have 9 different focus areas and all that, all around social justice issues, from LGBTQ to climate change to, you name it, they're looking at it and everything. And they do a great job with it, but it is so loud and so busy. Again, I'm looking for this nice, quiet reflection time. I think if I got it right. And, at worship, you had the Iona community, but you also had visitors on the island. Some, at times there'd be a cruise ship parked out there, a small one, and then they would all come to the island, come and see the Abbey, come and pray, join the services, and then they would go. You had to be, the last ferry off the island was at 6 p.m. So at 6:30, I'm like, the island kind of rests a little bit. It's the 40 people there. It's the people staying in the mini hotels there and all that, but it definitely quiets down quite a bit. And we never figured out that, no one really knew exactly what the structure used to be, but it was just off to the side. It's just an amazing old pathway, obviously. This is the Iona golf course, Jerry. And these are all, not golf balls, these are all just flowers. These are sheep and all that. And you just come and you tee off, they have markers in the holes just right there. They have a little rake real close to it so you can rake away the poop from the sheep and all that and get a good putt. Well, at least get a putt. And that just, I love that. And I've got another one of the holes. It's a little harder putt in some holes than others. And I'll show you that. This is walking down towards, this is St. Columba's Bay. They think this is where St. Columba landed when he brought Christianity into there. Our oldest son was baptized at St. Columba's Mission in Flagstaff, Arizona. So it's like, oh, I got to go there. And I was really excited to be a part of that, or to renew our baptismal vows there. But I definitely understand why we didn't, because this is the bay and all that is just solid rock. I think I've got the... Yeah, so that's me at the bay, but it's just big rock stuff, and not the place to bring a bunch of people to do a baptismal renewal. But again, just a great place to hike to. That's one of the crosses there at Iona. And then, so this is a little cell area, if you will, for monks to come in and pray. It was a great quiet space. The main church is right here, and the community area is over here. On that, on it, and at a certain time of the year, that cross lines up perfectly with the building and all that. We weren't there at that perfect time. This is the cloister area and all that. Again, very monastic feel there. And then this is the refectory. So this is where, again, you go to Christ in the desert, and it's quiet. You don't talk. You might hear have a reading as you eat and everything. this was so loud in there, and it just echoed in there. And again, great people had a great time sharing, but just very different. And that was one of my learning, my growing edges there. When I was a priest in Utah and even in New Mexico and some here, and I think I'm still there, I was always the one asked to go on camping trips and youth trips that were outside the adventure trips, because I could always change my plan in a second and all that. And, you know, you have to. Things change and all that. I found it very hard to put down my expectations. And also, to be honest, the expectations that I carried on the island, both on my own, but also of people I know, because everyone's like, oh, it's such a, you know, that is the thin place. And that expectation and I didn't realize until about 3 days in of how much I was carrying of other people's expectations. And also, you know, it took me a while to kind of say, you know what, this isn't what I'm going to find in this community of Iona, this, you know, at the Abbey. And so I need to shift and enter into it, or I can just be mad the whole time and all that, or not really mad, but just disappointed. And it took me a lot longer to shift gears than I expected. But again, an amazing community. I can see where people would love to go there, spend that week, build community. But if we would have known that was coming, I think we would have been a better place to receive it.
Right.
So this is a little creek that came down into the ocean on the white sands of Iona. So we renewed our baptismal vows here and everything. So just an amazing time of just kind of prayer. This is Michelle Danson and her husband. She's a priest here, and she was the priest on the trip as one of the leaders. She and Tracy Methy led it. And then, again, just an opportunity for all of us to pray with each other and renew our own baptismal vows. And this is the Bishop's House of St. Columba's Chapel. So they have services each week, each day and everything. And this is the chapel inside. We did one day go and have you, actually I went there two times. The Iona worship was great, but I was missing Eucharist and all that. So entered into there, again, just another. So it's the Scottish liturgy of 1982 is their new version and all. So, and then this is the boat that took us out to Staffa Island. And this is Staffa Island, just amazing chiseled cliffs there. And then up onto the growth. There is a big cave right here that you can hike to. We have 45 minutes on the island. They're like, you can easily go see the puffins and go over and see the cave in plenty of time. But I got there with the puffins and I didn't leave. I just decided I wanted to be with the puffins and all that. And a lot of us decided that. They are they're only about that big. I always thought they were bigger, but they also would come up and just, you could get so close. These are with my iPhone at the 2X magnification. All that. I was amazed. I thought to get any good pictures, I'd need a big telephoto lens. But that's me laying down with my boots. And I mean, literally, they were from me to Jay and all that, sometimes even closer and everything. So just some really cool birds. Just really colorful. That's definitely been on my bucket list for a long time. So that's the boat we came in on. And then so they dropped us off and came out into the sea and anchored until we were ready. And then this doesn't show it real well, but you can see the puffins would come out on the sea and grab a small fish and everything and bring it. And they, on the side of the hill and all that, that's where they have their nest and all that. And then they nest there and everything. So we kind of caught it at a perfect time. So I really enjoyed the puffins, as you can see.
First time there too.
So yeah, actually we had, when we got to the island of Iona, every day we had sunshine at part of it, and most days it was sunny all day. And people were like, we don't get this kind of weather. So we really lucked out once we got there, of course. Now that we're, yeah, as I say, we send it here to Colorado. And this, I love this little place. It was a little, it was right off the back of the chapel. The baptismal font is right here that we saw earlier. So the church goes all the way this way. It's at the very back. It has this little window. Ferns were growing off the wall and everything. They weren't planted there. They just grew and everything. But you could keep the door open. You could hear the service, but you could be there in silence and all that. Some people thought this window was a lookout, but it's on the inland side of the church. The coastal side is out by the chapel. So that didn't really make sense. But they don't know exactly what this was for. I thought maybe it was a monk that got to... you were put into seclusion and had to stay there But it was just so cool to sit there and worship in that space, kind of have your quiet own little chapel, if you will. You know, I mean, this does look out to the road that comes up to the Abbey and to the church. So some people were thinking it might be that they have had a person there saying, okay, everyone has come, now we can start the service and all that. But no one that we talked to was really clear about it. But it was such a cool room. So this is me one morning, listening to the service and praying from in there. I really found my space in there. I thought that was really cool. And this is looking out that door into the church. So that's the setup there, everything. This is us up by the Argyle Hotel. All right, it's one of multiple hotels, about four or five hotels there probably. The Oban Inn was a great one, not Oban, the Columba Inn was a great one. And then this one, so we had hiked most of the day doing something during the day, as long as we weren't working at the Abbey and all that, and then come here. As you enter the community of the Abbey, you enter into their workspace as well. So many people were, you know, had to clean bathrooms and clean the common areas, set up and clean up after meals. I was on program, so that meant there was another building where they did 3 days a week, they did a program. We had to make tea and get all the goodies out, be there for the program, and then halfway through we would serve that tea. It was great, other than every morning, or three of the five mornings we were there, I had to be on that site from 9 until 1. So, and then we went and had lunch, so it's kind of, could go do other things. But the programs are really interesting as well. But again, just something very different. So this is the challenging putt here. I have two lambs just sitting there by the golf course. There is a video out about the golf course on Iona and everything. So that was kind of cool, I thought. Again, this was my last day. This is my gin and tonic when I decided not to do the sing-along. And then this was our last morning. I got up early and the sunrise was just amazing, looking over the island there.
And the sunrise?
Sunrise there is about 5 a.m. No, I'd say I was a little earlier than here, but and it never, it got dark, but yeah, it, you know, by 10:30, 11, it was still sunny out and everything. So yeah, so I'd say probably 4 or 5 was sunrise. This, I could look and find out the exact time of the picture, but yeah. And so again, that's the Abbey there. They're still doing some construction. And this is the other cross that didn't have the crossbars anymore. And just so weathered. And you found these crosses all throughout the island. When we'd be hiking, all of a sudden, oh, there's another one of the Celtic crosses and everything. So there, it's not just on Iona, all throughout the island of Mull and on the main island of Scotland, we found all that. So, we had that one in twice. And then just in the old ship and everything there in the windows of the church. This is the last morning in the church, just kind of that quietness. And again, the refectory is a little bit calmer here. Fewer people were there. And then this is us leaving. So again, on Friday morning, everyone gets together and they walk you out. They walk you to the ferry. And this is, so here, in the back, they're bowing, they're sending us off, and then they're going waving as we got onto the ferry. And then this is the group, and Wendy and Wallace, and that's her waving us goodbye. And so this is one of the ferries going across. I think this one is actually going over to Oban, but they were ferries that covered, because this is a bigger one. I counted probably about 30 or 40 cars and or bigger trucks and people and everything going between the islands. And of course, in Oban, I went to the fly shop. It was like a sporting goods store with one little wall of fly gear and all that, but it was kind of fun. And then this, on our last day in Oban, as we were heading back, we stopped by the Oban Fish and Chips, had to get some fish and chips and everything. And Carl Andrews, who was with us last week, he had been over there and said, you have to go to Oban Fish and Chips. It's a white or a blue building with white lettering. And so, and it was good. It was real good. So, and then this is us heading to the airport out of Glasgow and all that. We left the hotel at 7 a.m. Glasgow time to catch the train, the bus and all that to get to the airport and then to fly home. And in Glasgow time, we landed in Denver at 8:30 a.m. that next day, that next morning. and all that. So it was about 20, for me, it was about 26 hours total of travel and everything. But a lot of it was sitting on planes, a lot of it was sitting in airports and everything. And then that's the Glasgow Express heading home. And that's it. And I should have ended with that picture. So yeah, my takeaways from this was be ready for God to appear in unexpected places. And again, that whole idea of God will be on Iona, or you know, that's where I'm going to feel the presence of God the most. God was all out, but it was really on that hike and in that mist and then just in the wilderness and everything. Be ready to shift gears and be ready for surprises and all. And also probably another one is read up a little bit more on where you're going. But everyone had read the website for the community of Iona and all that is not real clear of what you're walking into. It talks about it. And once you've been there, like, okay, now I can read it in there. But they need a really good statement. This is not a monastic place. It is not a place of silence and all. But no, it was a fabulous time. Again, I would go back to the community of Iona and stay in at the Abbey. I would just come with a very different expectation for people who want to learn about it. You know, they did all kinds of hikes as well on the island. They actually, when we went to see the puffins, the community, people from the community were on the same boat. We just happened to have chartered the same boat at the same time. They had 20 spaces, and we had our 13 spaces, whichever it was. But so they gave plenty of opportunities. It's a great opportunity, but you have to know kind of what you're going into with the community. If I went back, especially if I went back to a group, I would stay at the Bishop's Lodge, Bishop's House, and kind of be able to build your own retreat. We were ready to do what we were wanting and needing to do on that island, but we entered in and said, oh, we got to scrub all that because we really need to be a part of this. We're a third of that group. And all that, so we need to walk with them on that journey. So, yeah. Any questions, comments? I'm ready for the rest of my sabbatical. And actually, it's going to be really interesting to be at Christ in the Desert, to be at one of my trips is at Holy Cross Monastery in New York. That is 3 days of contemplative hiking with the monks. And they're very clear. This is silent hiking. You'll have two meditations a day, but it's silent hiking. So it's going to be really interesting to kind of look at and contrast those two. So I'm really looking forward to that. I will do this again in a heartbeat. I'll just be ready for something different. So, any questions, comments? If you're on Zoom and want to unmute, and if you have any questions, let me know there. Hopefully you're still with us. All right.
Glad you got some sunshine.
Yeah, no, well, yeah, we got some sunshine. It was beautiful. I've never been in that wet of an environment and everything, but it was some of the greatness of it was just being in a very different environment than I've ever been. So,
how was the food?
Food was great. We had to order. Like 3 weeks in advance, we get these menus of where we were staying, and it's like, okay. And when we stayed at the Ben Crockin Inn, that food was so great. And they had these lobster mac bites and all that. It was lobster macaroni and cheese, and they were deep fried. And I had that the first day, and then I had a bunch of other stuff. And that was an interesting thing because I have that gluten allergy, but people had said you might not have that over there. I had no problem eating, thank goodness, because every breakfast was just toast at the toast and porridge at the Abbey. But so I'm like, can I change my appetizer every day, every night we're here to these lobster mac bites and everything? But the food was great, a very, very big variety of stuff. I had one day the innards of what do they call it? I'm sorry,
haggis.
Yeah, I had something with haggis. Actually, one breakfast it was haggis and eggs, and that was really pretty good. And then another one, there was a haggis gravy or something. As long as I didn't think about what it was, okay. I'm not sure I'd order it, but
you see a lot of lamb.
I'm sorry. You know, not as much as I would have expected. And actually, we talked about, you know, we asked them about the, you know, how much they slaughter and all that. And to get them off the island and do all that is just not really worthwhile and all that. They can't make money with it and everything. So they don't, you know, they're just more to keep the grass down and all that. But there's not a big lamb harvesting and all that that you would think and everything. So.
They ship out the wool then?
You know, and actually, yeah, not a lot of wool going out too, because again, the whole process of getting it off the island and get to it, there's just not a big enough market and pricing for it. Because yeah, you would walk in along all the ground, there would just be wool laying around, and all of a sudden, you'd think they would shear them and all that, but they only shear them just for the well-being of the sheep when they need it, I guess.
So, Father Brian, is tourism the big piece of their economy then?
Yeah, especially on Iona, it's all tourism. But I mean, most of them go off the island. But the guy that took us to Staffa Island, he grew up there. His dad had a ranch there, a farm, and all that. And he has a little farm, but then he does these tours and all that stuff. So, yeah, a lot of tourism and everything. And then the island of Mole is a big enough island that there's a lot more industry there as well. So. Oh, yeah, thank you. Yes. They use the Iona Abbey worship book. You know, the music, you know, you think of Taze and all that. It's not Taze. It's very simple and just kind of singing, you know, almost, I hate to say it, you know, the bouncy ball and everything, kind of ding, 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 and all that. But it's simple and people can, and that's part of it. They can come together and listen to that. On Sunday morning, we had a Eucharist, and there was a Presbyterian minister. She was from up in Washington State, and she'd been there for a while. And there, and I won't read it all. I didn't have it marked here, but there's a welcoming to the Eucharist, and she said that walking up the aisle, and she just had it memorized. And it's like, we invite you to this table. It's Christ's table. He invited friend, foe, and the outcast. If you feel like you're an outcast here, you are welcome at this table. And just some amazing words as she, and just the way she presented it, that was kind of that, for me, that was that moment in worship. I'm like, oh my gosh. And so very different than from our much more liturgical way of doing things. And then she got up to the altar and she did, you know, a very short Eucharistic prayer and all that, and we had communion. But we had morning prayer and evening prayer every day, and then Eucharist on Sunday and everything. And then there was also a midday worship. And part of that was to make sure that tourists that came on the island had time to worship. Sometimes it was packed. Many evenings it was just us and all that, or us and a few people from the island. And everything, but yeah, and I've got the worship book. Actually, we used the morning prayer shortly after I got back. I was gone, I guess, for the mission trip and all that. And we used morning prayer here. Kay, you led that, right? From the Iona worship book and everything. So, and I'm hoping when I get back to pull a few Eucharistic prayers out of here and use some of that as well, you know, like with the bishop's permission, of course. Yes,
did that sense of history affect how you worshiped? Is that we went to communion at Westminster Abbey years ago, and
right.
Along where the, you know, the stone is
right.
Is, you know, worn from all the people walking, and you know, it was just that sense of history being in a whole different feel.
Right.
And so did you feel affected by that?
You had some of that, but the worship was so modern and different and all that it kind of it kind of was shocking to have that kind of worship in that kind of space and all that a little bit. But yeah, I mean, some of the stairs going down were very worn, but also this building had been destroyed and rebuilt and destroyed and rebuilt so many times. It wasn't, you know, it hasn't been in continuous use from 521 or mid 500s and everything. But it is neat. It was neat to kind of look. And then they had they had a museum. They had all kinds of stations outside where you could stop and listen and all that. Then they had the one of the hikes away was the monk's cell. And it was just a rock cabin. It didn't have any roof or the walls were only a couple. But that's where apparently St. Columba would go and just, that was his retreat spot. So, you know, it's kind of interesting to think, okay, back then, you still need a retreat spot even as you're leading a monastery. So, yeah. Any other questions from online? Any other questions here? Thank you. I hope that we ran a little more than an hour. I hope that was good enough. Didn't want to just bore you with a slideshow, a family slideshow of a trip. But yeah, I would definitely go again. It was just an amazing experience. And you know, again, feel like I need to say thank you for providing these opportunities for me as your priest. And I hope that it reflects and comes back to you in wonderful ways as my spirituality deepens as well. Eric.
One thing you wish you had taken and one thing you wish you had
taken. I wish I would have taken my gloves. And what's funny is the week before we left, it was raining like crazy here. So I put on all my rain gear and, you know, like, this is a great test. I put on my cover and I went out and I'm like, oh, I need gloves. And I texted everyone on the trip saying, hey, don't forget good, warm, waterproof gloves. I got out there and in my backpack, thank God, I had my sun gloves from fishing, those bright blue ones, Carrie, those little ugly ones. They have no fingers. And that's the only gloves I had. And I'm just like, really? And I got too busy before we left. And I kept looking. No, that's not the glove I need. When we got to Iona, I went and found a perfect pair of gloves. But on the island of Mull, there was just no place that had gloves and all that. So I wish I had gloves. I could have left behind my little clothesline thing. I had a clothesline thing that I thought I'd use in my room to clean our clothes because they wanted us just to take a carry-on bag and a backpack that would fit underneath the plane and all that. So packed really light. But there's plenty of places to hang clothes and all that in our rooms and everything. So, and luckily I got the luck of the draw. When we got to Iona, most of the rooms were 4 or 5 beds per room. They had 3 handicapped rooms. There happened to be 3 single men from our group. So they decided to put them in there. I got the one right next to that was attached, had a door to the handicapped bathroom. And they told me, they're like, just shut the door, lock the door. This is your bathroom and all that. And I'm just like, are you serious? So I gave a few people access to it if they needed. And it had 2 seats in it. So I could wash my clothes in 1 seat. There's a little controversy. It came up, it became very clear to some of the women on the trip that why is it that the 3 men get the very special rooms and all that? So that was a growing experience for us all. The Iona community, they're just like, just the sight of that is wrong and everything. The Iona community is like, that made the best sense with 40 people trying to get everyone into rooms. That made the best sense. But yeah. But I was like, thank you, Lord. But I was really, really quiet about it. So. All right, anything else? I probably should have brought 2 sets of hiking poles as well. But who would have thought? All right. Well, why don't we go ahead and close with the Lord's Prayer then? As our Lord and Savior has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you, everyone. And Kim, thank you for letting me know the slides weren't changing on your screen.